What we saw from some of our previous work was that if we had heat transfer from conduction, we had the equation Q is equal to minus Ka dT dx, or dT dr if we had circular conditions, or Q is equal to Ha delta T for convection, or if we write this in a more simplified term just for now, and the equation we had before, Q is equal to Ua delta T, where U was the overall heat transfer coefficient and A was the area. Delta T was the change in temperature across that system. There are going to be instances now where we are looking at the Q Ua delta T term where we want to increase the Q as much as possible. So we want heat transfer to happen. So what I mean by that is that we might have a system, and let's just use a pipe in this example, where we have hot water coming in on the left-hand side, and we want to cool it down as much as possible. So hot coming on the left, and we want it to come out at cold on the right-hand side. So in order to do that, what we are saying effectively is that how can we maximize the heat transfer or the heat loss across that pipe? If we look at the equation of heat transfer that we've got there at the moment, if we want to increase the Q, that means we need to increase the U, increase the A, or increase the delta T terms in order to be able to maximize the heat loss. If we look at those one by one and we start with delta U, how do we increase the U term? So U, if you recall, was part of the K from the conductive heat transfer coefficient as well as the H from convection. So to increase the heat transfer as well as the U, we're going to make sure that K is as high as possible. So in order to do that, we want to have metals. We don't want to have ceramics, we don't want to have insulators, we want something that'll encourage heat transfer. To increase the H, the easiest way to do that is to make sure that there is turbulence. So turbulence, we want to have high velocity flow, so that's the heat that's coming through the hot side here, sorry, the flow that's coming through the hot side on the left here. If we can have that as fast as possible, we'll get a turbulent flow and we'll increase the H as well as the U term. The second one on that list was the area. So if we can increase the area, we can also increase the overall heat loss to the system. So if we look at the pipe, the easiest way to increase that is by increasing the length. If we can increase the length, we'll have a greater surface area. So the surface area being the surface of this pipe as I'm shading it in here, if we increase the length, we'll increase that surface area and we'll increase the Q and the heat loss, which is what we want to do in this case. The third option, as we mentioned, was if we could increase the delta T. So we want to increase the delta T to maximize the heat loss. The delta T being the difference between the hot and the difference between the cold. Now the hot temperature is already specified in the question, so we can't change that. The second one we can look at is the cold temperature. How can we increase the cold temperature in the system? So if this is a pipe that's just going out into the atmosphere we can't necessarily control it, but we could put some fluid or flow some fluid over this pipe where I'm showing in the black arrows. If we could put some fluid to flow over these pipes, we could have a greater temperature difference if that fluid was cold. So one way to do that is the first type of heat exchanger that we're going to be looking at, and that is called a double pipe heat exchanger. So the double pipe heat exchanger is simply a pipe in a pipe. So there we have our original pipe, and if we had to put some jacket or a second pipe around this, we could then have a fluid flowing either in the same direction or in the opposite direction that comes around this jacket and fills this gap around the jacket, and thereby this cold fluid increases the delta T and we can then have a better heat transfer on that system. How do we now optimize this? The length we can increase and the cold temperature we can manipulate. So obviously the colder we make the cold flow, the better the heat transfer, and then the secondly is, can we make this as long as possible? So instead of just having one pipe like I've drawn it there, we could have a pipe. Let's just get this back. We could have a pipe that is now not just one length of the page, but it now doubles back and it extends as far as we want this to extend. So we now have a longer pipe. So if we have this longer pipe, and we then put the jacket around that, that should optimize the heat transfer as well. If we look at a neater drawing of that, there we have our double pipe heat exchanger. So now we have it going in the opposite direction as to how I had it previously, but we have on the bottom right here, we have something called the tube side in. So in my diagram, this was the hot fluid that is now flowing into this pipe, and it will double back onto itself and then around again, all the way until it comes out at the tube side fluid out at the top. So there we have the more optimized system. We still have the cold fluid, as for my previous example, here on the top called the shell side fluid in, and you can see that there's a jacket that's running around this fluid as it goes down the length. We have a bit of a neat arrangement here so that it cuts across and goes along again, cuts across and then goes to the bottom, around and out the bottom. We simply have that arrangement so that at this flange on the top left and the same thing at the bottom right, we can have a system where we can take these two pipes off to help with the cleaning of these pipes if that needs to be. If we try and consider this in three dimensions, it might look something like this. The next question is, how can we make this system even more efficient? So we've already increased the length, we've increased the delta T. So the obvious one is to go even further and to make this even bigger. So if I try and make this in the same color, we now make that pipe go around and around a million times, and we can have this going over and over. If we have such a system, what we are also actually going to do is that this jacketed system that we drew earlier in my blue scribble lines at the top now becomes slightly inefficient. So we're just going to have a single case around this entire system so that the water can then flow in this big mess all around the entire system. Once we change to that type of system, we now have something called a shell and tube heat exchanger. And the shell and tube, we have this shell thing on the outside. So that was the original jacket. And the tubes are all the tubes that are running on the inside as we had before. So let's see what a neater version of that looks like. So there we have the same system again, where this time we have on the shell side, the shell side, we come on the top there and coming on the bottom. So this is the cold fluid, so I should have this in blue. So the cold fluid coming in on the shell side at the top, coming out on the right, and you can see it flows through the system. There are blue lines that are already here. They flow between these green lines and then out again. So that is the tube. We still have the shell, so the shell was the original jacket. This is now on, the tube side. The tube where the hot fluid was flowing in on our previous one, and we can see that we have these lines that are now going into individual tubes, and they flow all the way through until they come out on the right-hand side, on that side. One addition that we have in this is that we have baffles. So the baffles are these big dark black lines that I'm now drawing. So these dark lines are on the shell side, and this helps to mix the fluid around a little bit more easily so that it doesn't just run in a straight line from the top in and out the bottom again. This example is called a one pass, and it's written in the heading here, one pass tube side, because it's only going, the tubes are only running around once. We can get an example where we have a two pass tube side. So this is a similar example, except now the hot fluid on the tubes. So again, it's the tube side. Let's make this just so that we can see on the hot, as I had in the previous example. In terms of the tubes, it's now coming in on the top right-hand side. It flows through the tubes. So these are the green tubes that are flowing on the top half. It comes out on the right-hand side. So that's one pass. It then doubles back and goes back again through that system to come out on the right-hand side in our second pass. So let's just clear that so you can see it a bit more clearly. Again, we still have on the cold side or on the shell side fluid that comes in on the top right hand side, and it again flows through the arrows as we had before around the baffles for better mixing, and then out on the bottom. A third option that we could have is a U-tube heat exchanger. So instead of having that two-pass system, we now have a bend on the end. It doesn't go out and back in again, but you can notice the hot fluid. It again comes in and out on the right-hand side through the same side. On the end, though, all the tubes are bent. So we can get them bending through like that. Again, if we look at this in 3D, you can see how the tubes fit inside the shell and then go back together again. So this shell and tube heat exchanger, this type of example, we could have the fluid flowing in the same direction. We could have it flowing in the opposite direction. In this example, let's rather go back to the first example to make it a little bit easier. Let's rub this out. We could have two configurations. It's either flowing in the same direction. So if it's flowing in the same direction, it will be called a co-current configuration. Or if it's flowing in opposite directions, so you'll see it's coming in on the left-hand side as the hot and out on the right-hand side, and the opposite for the cold water. So it's coming in the opposite side. The opposite side flow, so when it's not going in the same direction, that is a counter current setup. If we had to swap the flow around of one of them, so let's just say we swap the flow for the shell side, so the shell side has opposite, so I'm crossing these out, and if we had to flow in on the bottom left, going in that side and coming out at the top, that would be a co-current arrangement. For this course, we are only going to be looking at shell and tube heat exchangers in the co- and counter-current configuration, as well as the double pipe heat exchanger configuration. We will not be looking at any other heat exchanger configurations. So please make sure you understand these examples on how they're set up, as well as the maths that is in the notes and will be in follow-up videos.